Okay, so this is a little bit of what we do at an undisclosed location. We're basically shooting some stuff for the Patreon channel. We've got a little bit of a mess here, but this is where we're gonna spar today. So they're gonna get some of the sparring footage. It'll be slow motion, and so I shoot it at 120 frames per second. But this is the luxurious process to go through to get that. So we set it up with the C-stand so that we can mount the one camera on top. And we've got our standard equipment out here and the Blackmagic, which will be on a separate angle. That will be the one that also gets the high frame rate. And then we go into the glorious stuff that I will be doing.
ASMR?
Yep. Yep. That's nice and quick job. We're gonna go set up the cameras first, then we're gonna go into sparring. This is a C-stand. So a C-stand is really heavy. It's got some good weight to it, so that I can put a camera, I can put the Blackmagic on there, or GH4, or the iPhone with its stabilizer, which is what you're being through right now. So it'll go up about 10, 12 feet, and then it can still go out another 4 feet out beyond that. This is really essential if you want to do something stabilized, and this works for lighting as well. So a lot of it is figuring out what angles I need to shoot at, but we're gonna shoot high so that I have something to take a look at overall. And then I'm gonna shoot low so that I have something also to shoot from a different perspective. Sometimes that low angle shots are really cool, but it's nice to have a reference footage from above that we basically, we clap hands so that I can tie up the audio later and sync them both. Next is just getting us in place and going. And I like to bump up the shutter speed so that there's very little motion blur whatsoever. We usually shoot at 60 or 120 frames per second for some of the pristine slow motion that our Patreons get and some of the other footage that I put up on my regular Core JKD channel, YouTube channel. When we're shooting at, say 120 frames, I've got to have a minimum shutter speed of 240. But I will, again, I don't want the 180 degree shutter speed, so I break that down to making that, 500 and above. This is our scale for determining where our exposure values are. So if I bring them too far low here, you can see the overall dimness. And while the Blackmagic can recover a lot, it gets a little noisy if you shoot this way and then try to expand it in post. Now, what I do is I'm changing the ISO values to 400. I bring the f-stop the widest it can go. In this case, it's 3.6. And because we're still here on the low end, I'm going to drop that, see where that goes. And the nice thing is that's great. That gives me leeway either side. And I don't have to worry about anything getting blown out. It's a nice cloudy day. People in the UK must love it for filming because they don't have to deal with all this overexposure and things like that, which changes second by second here in Florida. But on this, if I want to make it just a little bit lighter, I can change that as well. Here you can just double tap and you can put in whatever. If I wanted at 350, I can get 350 on my shutter. So the Blackmagic allows you to really just dial in what you want. So, and that's where it stays. That's about where we're gonna go. It gives me some flexibility in case it starts getting, the exposure goes up because of the sun and the clouds. It's far enough down here on the low end that when it starts creeping up, it won't blow out highlights too much. And that's that. That's how we do it. You're not looking at a still image. What you're seeing is happening in slow motion. Some of you have asked for a little more information on this, so I'll touch on it here. Let me know if you want more. This is what's possible when you shoot in 120 frames per second, and then later use DaVinci Resolve to apply extreme slow motion. I think it does a beautiful job. On my other channel, I've tested other software for their speed ramping and slow motion quality, including After Effects, Twixter, Final Cut Pro, Nuke, and so on. I've found that none of them equal what DaVinci Resolve can do right out of the box with almost no work, other than having a good graphics card to speed up the process. The knife sparring shown here is something our Patreons will get a lot more of, including my breakdowns of what's happening. Pristine slow motion like this depends on how well the software interpolates the in-between frames where there's no information. DaVinci Resolve and many of the other high-end software uses something called optical flow processing to calculate the in-between frames. What DaVinci does to enhance this process is to use something called speed warp. This uses their neural engine, basically machine learning and AI, to figure out the in-between frames. As you can see, it does this very well. I'm going to show it at normal speed now, and then apply speed ramping to it in DaVinci, which allows me to selectively slow down only parts of the action that I want highlighted. As some of you know, knife sparring and knife attacks happen very fast. It's nice to be able to slow it down and see the details like this. All right, so that was how we set up for a scene, like for sparring and stuff like that. We did, like I said, the conditioning beforehand, and which usually is 100 squats minimum, and then we did some bridge overs, we did some push-ups and push-ups on the ball, things like that. That was a light warm-up, so, and then we went into the sparring, several one-minute rounds. I forget how many of it was. Then we went into, and the reason that we go into 1 minute rounds is because we are working for getting the fight over fast. We're working for maximizing the amount of tools that we have and their capabilities within a short period of time. So we need to be able to fire and fire accurately and without a lot of wasted effort. And that's why we do it in a marathon type setup of several 1 minute rounds, you know, 5, 6, 7 1 minute rounds right after each other. But each 1 minute is an intense all-out type training. So that's kind of an interval type. And then there are other times where we'll go 3 minute and 5 minute. And sometimes, you know, it's a half an hour for grappling, you know, stand up, whatever else. So we keep it challenging, we keep changing it up. Some of you have asked, you know, how the filming process worked and how we actually did that. And this is an example. A lot more of the footage is going to go up to the Patreons, so I'll break down some of the techniques there. But we use things like the color checker here, which is an X-Rite color checker. I don't often use that for color as much as I do for the focus card and the white balance. You basically can white balance to your grays, or you can white balance to whites. In here today, it was a beautiful day for filming because it's cloudy, there are no harsh shadows, we get a great just little specular highlight and so forth. But it's also a nice day for sparring. It was cool enough today, we're in the 70s, and that works really well for what we need to do. When we're sparring in, you know, 80 some percent humidity with including in rain, we've done that. and you're sparring with the gear on and things like that. It is exhausting on many different levels, but we play that gamut. So as cold as it'll get, we will be out training. That's just the nature of our training. And we train on concrete, we train on grass, we train on so forth. The reason we did on concrete here today and because of this setup was because it was a nice setup for filming so that we can present it to you. I'm out of my little packet of extra lenses. We also have the Rode Wireless Go mics, and that's what I've got on here. It's a little transmitter pack that has a lav mic that runs up underneath here. And the reason I'm putting it under here is because it's windy, and anytime there's wind, if I can put this under the shirt, then it disperses a lot of that buffering. We save your ears and comfort listening. And so we did the knife training today. We did knife attack training. So that always comes with its hazards. You have to train, depending on the type of gear you've got, you've got to be careful, because some of the headgear like this is meant for more of the knife slashing type training. That means the blade can come across like this and you aren't going to, you know, fear damaging your partner's eyes. This, however, is a problem. And this is great because you can really crack it, but you also learn how much you can extend your knuckles across that too, because this is metal, it is unforgiving, and you will get some damage to the joints. So you have to be careful on that, but that's preferred. This will not stop thrusts, so you've got to get clear plates for that. And we used to train with that. We're trying to work specific training. Military training is very different than civilian training, which is very different than law enforcement training. And we cover the scope. All of Core JKD has a fundamental base system. And that, once trained, it doesn't matter what technique you put on there, as long as the technique is efficient and blends well with other techniques and works for the majority of people using it. And I have a very honed system for that, and that's what Core JKD is about, and that's what a lot of my group leaders and instructors are learning and still working in their training. So we got Brian out in Austin, Denton, Texas. Brian out in Denton, Texas. We've got Marco Hildebrandt, our representative for Core JKD in Germany. He recently had some of their Little Ninja tournament. You see the techniques that he is instilling in these kids, and their fundamentals that work really well. It's just great to see that. So check Brian out there, check Marco Hildebrandt out there. We've got Dugout East, so we've got a few others that are coming up, and we'll let you know more about them. Right now, Brian is accepting students out there, and Marco is definitely training and teaching Core JKD, including weapons and the different variations. And we're gonna go get some food, gonna clean this up and then go get some food. We hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please thumbs up. Please check out the Patreon page. It really helps support us doing this long-term, and it also helps support us in some really cool stuff we really want to do, but we need some support. If nothing other than just giving the thumbs up and subscribing, if you subscribe, that really, really, it helps us in the numbers game in YouTube. And also, if you can do just even $1 a month, I tell you, we'll make it worth your while. We've got some really cool slow motion stuff like this that you're going to be seeing up there for the Patreons. If you can afford $1 a month, it's valuable to us. We really do appreciate it. Thank you.